Well, good morning. Welcome to Redemption Church. My name is Josh. I'm one of the pastors here. Thank you for getting out and carrying a little risk in these days to gather together. Wise risk, mitigated risk. For those of you who are at home who, for one reason or another, are making the wise decision to join us online, we're glad you're here as well. Regardless of whether you're physically present with us or scattered across the tri-state, we take comfort and confidence that we serve a God who is not limited by space, who is not limited by power and ability. Been thinking through that this past week in a number of environments and talking about God's attributes, that we are operating with a God who is unlimited and does all things effortlessly. And in thinking about where God dwells, in prepping and in welcoming us and calling us into worship, I thought of Isaiah 57:15. Thinking, again, not spatially, but where God's presence is viscerally felt, where He reveals to us He will meet us. Listen to this, two places. Isaiah 57:15. For thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. Look at this. I dwell in the high and holy place. That's one. And also with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit. Thought that was interesting. That if you want to meet with the Lord, if you want to experience His presence, He is in the high and lofty place of holiness, where we see Him as transcendent and big and excellent and perfect. So we come this morning saying, God, we want to repent of our sin. We want to pursue holiness. We want to pursue righteousness and justice. We want to be godly, godlike. And so part of our gathering is to see you big like that. The other way is we get low and contrite, broken over the fallenness of our world, broken over the suffering in which many are experiencing pain and loss, lowness over our sin and broken over the effects of that in our life. So as we sing these songs of Christmas, which are great songs, showing God transcendent and big, but yet imminent and close and humble in meeting us, taking on the form of a servant, of a man. Let's have no place this morning for the mushy middle of just sort of apathy and content in our godliness, but instead say, God, we want to meet you high and big. And as a way to get there, we're going to get low and contrite and broken before the Lord. Take away from us all lukewarmness, all sort of laziness and apathy. Let me pray for us before we get into these songs. God, thank you for being a God that is big and trustworthy, who is sovereign and high and over all things, and yet choosing in your love and mercy and kindness to revive our spirits, to meet us where we are, to meet us in our need, and then not only personifying that posture, but actually accomplishing how that can be possible and beneficial through the person of your Son, Jesus Christ, the God-man, truly God, truly man, doing what only God can and accomplishing for us in your life, in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, only what we ought as humanity. So we identify with Him. We lay hold of Him by faith, coming into your presence, accepted, approved, known, and loved. We ask it in His name, Redemption Church said.
Amen. My name's Tim, one of the pastors here. I'm going to ask you to stand and sing with us I want to give you an overview of where we're heading with these songs, these Christmas songs today. So Christmas songs are merry and bright, right? And holly and jolly, except that some of them aren't. The really ones that I love aren't. So we're playing a couple songs today in a minor key, right? So darker. So the first one we're singing is O Come Emmanuel. If you look at Luke 2, it starts out, in those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus, which means the Romans were in charge, not the Jews. They were oppressed. They were longing for Messiah. They were 400 years of silence in between the Testaments and your Bible where God didn't speak, and they were dark times. It was dark. Life was not good, which is very reminiscent of the lives we've lived in the past year. So we're going to sing this song in a minor key with darkness and heaviness and weight of our own sin and the need for our Savior to come, the promised Messiah who's on his way. But, wow, it's hard to have hope. But there is a thrill of hope. So let's try this out.
To be your redemption time is once again. The decree went out, and then things start happening, a census, and Mary and Joseph go and follow the law to be registered, and she gives birth to her son. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appears. An angel of the Lord appears to these shepherds, just doing their jobs. And declares to them the Savior, the Messiah, the long-waited-for Messiah has been born. And you need to go check it out. And so this chorus is in Latin, Gloria in excelsis Deo. That is, glory to God in the highest for who he is and what he's done. So let's sing this one together. Give me that E chord.
Angels, we have heard on high.
Luke 2. So they went with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph, and they found the baby lying in the manger, a feed trough. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told concerning the child. Hey, listen, we're here because this angel just showed up and like said that this is the Messiah. So like, can we come in and like check your kid out? And they did, because Mary and Joseph knew. They had already gotten visits from angels in dreams, and they knew what was coming. And so this progression that we've gone on through Luke 2 is longing and expectation. It's the need for a Savior. It's the pronouncement of the Savior from the Lord. And then it's the drawing near to the Savior to worship. So what child is this?
Shepherds God.
Sacrificial death for our full atonement, being raised from the grave so that we could have hope. And we long for your return, for your second advent. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Tim. My name is Greg. I'm not Josh, but I am one of the pastors here. And I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. We are taking a short break from Pastor Josh's Job series, and we're going to do what we usually do this time of year here at Redemption Church. We are going to do a Christmas series, and we're going to do a Christmas series on the songs of Christmas, not Jingle Bells or Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer, nothing like that, but the songs that are in the Bible, the Christmas songs that are in the Bible. You might not realize this, but there are some songs sung by biblical characters that point us to the Advent, that point us to the birth of Christ. And so over the next few weeks, as we move into the Advent season, we're going to teach you how to sing. And so I get the privilege this morning to teach you how to sing. And you might say, well, Greg, who are you to teach me how to sing? You can't sing. You don't know that, do you? Back in the early to mid-90s, I was actually a member of the very elite Spring Valley Freedom Baptist Church choir. We were very elite. I sang tenor in the choir. My wife, Kim, was in the choir, too. You sang alto or soprano or whatever ladies sing. And we were very talented. We were very gifted. We were very good as a very good choir to sing in. And back then, when you belonged to a Baptist church, a Southern Baptist church, there were two groups of the congregation, those who sang in the choir and those who listened to the people who sang in the choir. And that's how the Baptist church was made up. So we sang in the choir, and we very much wanted to be like a specific choir that we held up as our kind of choir heroes. And that was the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. And if you've never heard of the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir, you need to go home and YouTube them, and you will be in awe. They are, as far as choirs go, they are at the very top elite. They're just awesome to listen to. We were nothing like them. Okay, as much as we wanted to be like them, we were nothing like them. But we were good enough that every year around this time at Advent, we would always do our annual multi-church Christmas cantata. Okay? And those of you who don't know what a Christmas cantata is, you're really missing out on the Advent season. The churches in this area would get together, like-minded churches, and the choirs would come together, and we would sing together, and we would sort of not really compete, but we would work really hard to show the congregation who loved Jesus the most. And so it ended up being kind of a competition on who could sing the best. And let me tell you something, we sang the Hallelujah Chorus, and wow, it was just tremendous. But every year at the very end of the cantata, we always saved our secret weapon for last. And her name was Stacy Carroll. And Stacy could sing. I don't mean she could sing like the choir. Okay, I don't mean she could sing like the special music people that did solos. I mean Stacy could sing like she belonged in a recording studio or on a stage by herself. She could sing. And so every year at the very end of the cantata, now you might have to close your eyes for this and picture this, because it's just a fabulous biblical scene. Okay, every year at the end of the cantata, the lights in the sanctuary would go out, and it'd be total darkness, and then the music would start. Boom. And then you would hear fog machines. I kid you not, we had fog machines because they're biblical, okay? And then all of a sudden, you would see laser lights flicker through the fog. And it would light up the sanctuary, lasers shooting through the fog. And then out of the fog, bathed in those laser lights, wearing a white robe, stepped Stacy Carroll. And she sang the same song every year because it worked. Mary, did you know? And one year she was even pregnant when she sang it. She was like 8 or 9 months pregnant, I believe, when she sang. It was awesome. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? That this child that you'll deliver will soon deliver you. What an awesome, awesome scene. And I know, as corny as you all think that might have been back then, it was still just a little glimpse into what the Advent season is all about. As we use our voices to project the glory and awesomeness of our God and Savior. But the title of my message this morning is not how to sing like Stacy, as good as she was and still is. The title of my message is not how to sing like the Spring Valley Freedom Baptist Choir or even the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. But the title of the message today is how to sing like Mary. Mary, the teenage mother of Jesus. Mary. How to sing like Mary. And Mary begins her song in Luke chapter 1. So if you'll turn to Luke chapter 1, right before the very famous Luke chapter 2, the Christmas story, is Luke chapter 1. And she begins her song in verse 46 by saying, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And so traditionally this song is titled the Magnificat. Okay, the Magnificat. Not magnificent, because we're not talking about Mary's voice or her performance or the angel choir in the background, but Magnificat, which means to magnify. So Mary's song is about magnifying God. Mary's song focuses our eyes and our ears and our hearts and our souls on the majesty and magnification of God. Now, to magnify God does not mean that we make God bigger, all right? God, we cannot make God any bigger than He already infinitely is. But to magnify God means that we see God for who He truly is. And not only that we see God for who He truly is, but we help others to see God for who He truly is. And in seeing God for who He truly is, we worship Him with everything we are. There's a passage, and this is off script a little bit. There's a passage in 1 Chronicles chapter 16 where David, King David, brings the ark to the tent, and he's getting ready to take the ark into the tent. And he stops and he addresses the congregation. And this is what he says in song or prayer or whatever it is. This is what he says. He says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon His name. Make known His deeds among the peoples. Sing to Him. Sing praises to Him. Tell of all His wondrous works. Glory in His holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. And sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous works among all the people. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and He is to be feared above all gods. Splendor and majesty are before Him. Strength and joy are in His place. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the people. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come before Him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. Listen, we don't gather as a people on a Sunday morning to listen to a few people perform. Okay? This is not the choir up here and you are the people listening to the choir down there. You are the choir. You are the voices. And just a side note here, Pastor Tim has been leading our worship for the last few weeks. And as the elders of Redemption Church get together, we have longed to help create an environment where you can sing, where you can worship freely. Not so that you are listening to people singing and listening to people worship, but you are participating in that worship. And so Pastor Tim has kind of taken over the leadership of that, and he's done that for two reasons. One is so that you can hear yourself worship, and the other is so that he can preach the gospel, the good news through song, the grace and the mercy of Christ. And I don't know if you've noticed or not, but every once in a while Tim's singing, he'll back off the mic. You notice that? He just stops singing and step back like this. And it's not because he needs to clear his throat or he forgot the lyrics, and not every time at least. This is so you can hear each other sing. This is so you can come collectively before the Lord and as a congregation and sing in one voice. Listen, Tim is incredibly gifted as a musician. He won't tell you that and he'll deny it, but I'm telling you, he's incredibly gifted as a musician. But Tim's goal is not that you would hear him sing or play and be in awe. His goal as a pastor is that you would hear each other sing and be in awe of God. That's what worship is all about. So, what does any of that have to do with Advent or Christmas or Jesus' birth or Mary's song? Well, if we're going to sing as a church, if we're going to sing in a way that magnifies God, we are going to sing like Mary sings. Very powerful song that she sings here. She says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And so the question that we're going to ask of this passage and hopefully answer in two or three points here is this: how can we magnify God? How can we exalt the Lord with our voices? How can we sing like Mary? And I'm an old-fashioned preacher. I use points, so I have three main points here that I want to deliver to you. You can write them in the margin of your Bible in Luke chapter 1. But the first answer to that question is this: Mary's song magnifies the Lord by rejoicing in a Savior. This is how all our songs should work out. All our songs should rejoice in a Savior. And Mary's song leads us in that direction. My soul magnifies the Lord, verse 47, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for He has looked on the humble estate of His servant. Listen, that's what Christmas is all about, rejoicing in a Savior. And despite what the Roman Catholic Church may teach about Mary, Mary was not sinless. You understand that, right? Mary was not sinless. She needed a Savior. She sang about needing a Savior because of her humble estate, because of her lowliness, because of her faults, like us, because of her sinfulness. She needed a Savior. I heard a pastor say not too long ago, and this is really powerful, and I wrote it down in the margin here. Christmas is always an indictment before it's ever a delight. Christmas is always an indictment on our sin before it's ever a delight in a Savior. Luke chapter 2, verse 11, unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, right? We all memorize that. A Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Matthew 1:21, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Listen, if you don't need a Savior, you don't need Christmas. It's just a bunch of bells and whistles and shopping and commercialism and consumerism. If you don't need a Savior, there's no need for Christmas. Christmas will mean nothing to us until we feel the desperate need for a Savior. When I was a child, I saw a movie that really moved me. And when I was a child, we didn't have Netflix and, of course, and Amazon Prime and Hulu and all those things where you could watch unlimited movies. You watched what was on Channel 3, Channel 8, or Channel 13, or you didn't watch anything. And I remember vividly laying in my living room floor as a small child, and the movie Ben-Hur came on. Those of you who are a little bit older, you probably remember the movie Ben-Hur with Charlton Heston. Let me tell you something. Anything biblical with Charlton Heston came on, you listened. He was like Moses. Well, he was Moses, wasn't he? But anyway, Ben-Hur, and the fellas, the star of the movie was named Ben-Hur. His first name wasn't Ben. His last name wasn't Hur. His last name was Ben-Hur. Okay, his first name was Judah. And Judah Ben-Hur was a very devout Jew. And he was arrested under fictitious charges by the Roman government. And he was cast into slavery. And so there was this one particular scene. And I want you all to go home and, you want to see a Christmas movie, go home and watch black and white Ben-Hur. Okay? I mean, Roman chariots and gladiators and all this Christmas stuff. So, but Ben-Hur, Judah Ben-Hur, is wrongly convicted. And he's arrested by the Roman government. He's put in chains. And he's being taken to the galleys. You know what the galleys are, right? The big slave ships. And they're going to put him on a slave ship. So he's chained together with all these other slaves. And they're walking through the desert. And they come up to Nazareth. And they're stopping in Nazareth. The Roman guards are going to water their horses. The slaves are parched. They're dying of thirst. And they're just going, water, water, we need water. And the people, the townspeople from Nazareth, come out with little bowls of water to give to him, and the Roman guards just knock them out of their hands, say, no water for them. And they take water and they give to their horses, and the Roman guards drink the water and they pour it on the ground. And these slaves, especially Ben-Hur, he's just, water, water. Well, in the background, there's this little scene where there's a carpentry shop. And there's this carpenter, and he's working on something, and he stops and he puts his tools down. And he walks out. And you never see his face. You only see his back. And he walks out and draws some water into a bowl. And Ben-Hur's already passed out. He's on the ground. He's dying. And the shadowy figure kneels down to Ben-Hur. And he pours a little bit of that water on his head. And strokes his hair. And Ben-Hur looks up. And he gives a little bit of water in his mouth. And Ben-Hur looks up. And never shows this character who he is. But Ben-Hur looks up and he's just... he's stunned. And he continues to give him water and water. And finally, one of the Roman guards looks over. I told you, no water for them. And he comes walking over and he sees this figure and he stops and he goes like this. And for like 20 seconds, they lock eyes. It never shows this guy's face, but they lock eyes. And the Roman soldier goes like this. He goes, and he turns and he walks away. And Ben-Hur continues to drink the water. The slaves eventually are watered and they all walk out. But Ben-Hur keeps looking back and looking back at this shadowy figure. And they never tell you in the movie. They never show his face. But you know that that shadowy figure, that carpenter, is Jesus. Giving a cold drink of water to a dying slave. That's us. That's us in need of a Savior. That's Mary, the mother of Jesus, needing a Savior. That's the woman who bathed Jesus' feet with her tears and dried his feet with her hair. That's the woman at the well who had to come to the well in the noonday sun because she had five failed marriages and she didn't want to hear the scoffs from the other women. So she had to come with her empty buckets in the noonday sun. But guess what? Guess who was there in the noonday sun sitting on the well? Jesus. And Jesus took her empty buckets and he filled them with living water because she needed a Savior. And Jesus was that Savior. I need a Savior. You need a Savior. We all need a Savior. That's what Christmas is about. And when we see Jesus as that Savior, all we can do is magnify God. All we can do is see God for how great He is and tell others and show others how great He is. And sing His praises for rescuing us. So Mary's song focuses on a Savior. That's the first thing. The second thing is this, Mary's song is focused on God's attributes. Pastor Josh talked about God's attributes at the very onset of our service today. But Mary's song focuses on God's attributes, as all our songs that we sing to God should. They should talk about God's attributes. And when I use that word attributes, generally speaking, we're talking about God's omniscience, His omnipresence, and His omnipotence. Okay? His omnipotence, He is ruler of all things. His omniscience, He knows all things. His omnipresence, He is everywhere at all times. Those are, generally speaking, the attributes of God. But within those main attributes are a myriad of other attributes about God. As the Westminster Shorter Catechism notes, God is a spirit. He is infinite, eternal, unchangeable in His being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. Just to name just a few of the attributes of God. And it is God's attributes that help us answer the three most important questions in the universe that all believers should and unbelievers should be forced to answer, and that is, who is God, what is God like, and how should I respond to Him? All of God's attributes should work to answer those three questions. So all of the songs we sing should also work to answer those questions. Who is God? What is God like? And how should I respond to what God is like? Now, with that in mind, look back up at the last half of verse 48. Mary says, "For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed." Okay? Why is Mary to be called blessed? Now, again, the Roman Catholic Church has taken this and they've taken this verse and they say we need to refer to Mary as the Blessed Mother of Jesus, the Blessed Mary. And she is blessed because she is sinless. And she is blessed because she is the eternal virgin. And she is blessed, so we need to carry a rosary around and say the rosary. And she is blessed because we need to say so many Hail Marys so she can forgive us for our sins, because she is an intercessor between us and Jesus and God. And I look at the context of Luke chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2. I don't see any of that. None of that. And trust me, when you pull a verse out, you better have context to argue what that verse means. That's how we decide what certain passages and certain verses mean. And if we look at the context of this passage and the meaning of Mary's song, we can see that Mary is blessed because of the attributes of God. The entire song is Mary pointing to who God is, what God is like, and how we should respond to God. It's not pointing to her. She says, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. Well, yes, she's blessed because she is the mother of Jesus, our Savior. But then she goes to point towards the attributes of God. I'm blessed because of this. And she says, for behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed, for he, at four is a because, because he who is mighty has done great things for me. So the first attribute of God she points to is she sings of God's mightiness or God's might. Now, what do you think of when you think of God's might? Our God is a mighty God. We can't do any justice to that mightiness within our own thoughts and imagination, so we have to turn to Scripture. And in Scripture, there are plenty of places to see God's mightiness. One place in particular that I always think of is Job chapter 38. And I'm not going to steal Pastor Josh's thunder because I know he's going to go there when we continue the series on Job. But Job chapter 38 speaks of God laying the foundations of the earth, determining its exact measurements, setting its cornerstones, shutting the sea in with doors, telling the waves how far they can go, storing the snow and the hail in the storehouses of heaven, and directing lightning bolts with his hands to the exact point to where which they should land. That's mighty. Or Psalm 78, I believe it is. Psalm 78, where he divides the sea so the Israelites can walk through on dry land, or when he rains manna from heaven so they can be fed, or when they get tired of the manna and they cry out for meat. How do you feed 600,000 men and their families with meat? Well, you bring in quail like the sand in the sea, and they land in the camp, and the people go out and eat the quail until they're satisfied. That's the mightiness of God. Or Isaiah 40 that tells of God measuring the waters of the earth in the palm of his hand. Or measuring the distance with the span, the distance of a universe with a span. This is like a span right here. Yeah, the universe, it's about that big to God. Weighing the mountains on a scale. All those passages and more speak of the mightiness of God. But do you know what Mary probably thought of when she sang about the mightiness of God? I think Mary thought of a God that could take a lowly, insignificant, frightened teenage girl and make her part of bringing God in the flesh to this earth, and a Savior and a Messiah to God's people. That's mighty. And that's the mightiness that Mary sang of. Don't ever underestimate the mightiness of God in the simple things in your life. He's doing 10,000 things at any given time. And as John Piper says, maybe we're aware of 3 of them, or 2 of them, or 1, or none. But he is a mighty God. And holy is his name, she says. So not only does Mary sing about God's might, but she sings about God's holiness. Now here's an attribute that is often neglected in our songs: the holiness of God. And here's an attribute we definitely need to sing more about. Not just because Mary sings about it in Luke chapter 1, but because of what the prophet Isaiah witnessed in Isaiah chapter 6. You remember Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah comes before the throne of God, and he sees God in all his splendor and majesty and glory, and the train of his robe fills the temple, and there's lightning and fog, and I told you those fog machines were biblical, and there's a seraphim, and they're flying around, they're covering their eyes and their feet with their wings, and they're singing what? Do you remember what they're singing? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy. They sing about his holiness. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the foundations of the earth shook, and the place was filled with smoke. And Isaiah cried out, "Woe is me, for I am not holy, and I am before a holy God." Revelation chapter 4, John kind of sees the same scene. And the angels are crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come." He is holy. Incidentally, the Hebrew word for holiness here means to cut. to separate, to be cut off or be separate from everything else, everything else. It means to be distinct from anything and everything. And it also carries a second meaning. That second meaning is that it's not only separate from everything and distinct from everything, but it's absolutely, entirely, morally pure all the time in every way possible. And there's only one person that that describes, and that is God. And so why do the angels around God's throne emphasize His holiness? And that's why they say it three times. It's an emphasizing of His holiness. Why is this their constant calling? Why is this their eternal song? Well, Pastor Paul Tripp says it best, I think, and he says this, and I quote him, "It's only in the face of the holiness of God that you and I, like Isaiah, like John, will ever be broken by the disaster of the sin that lives within us." Only when we look at God's holiness, only when we sing of God's holiness, will we see our sin for what it truly is. It's the holiness of God that tells us we cannot escape ourselves, and we all need a Savior who can do what we can't do, rescue us from ourselves. Which leads directly to the third attribute in God, in Mary's song. She sings about His might, she sings about His holiness, and then she sings about His mercy. She sings about His mercy, and His mercy is for those who fear Him from generation to generation. Listen, without the mercy of God, the mightiness of God would overwhelm us, and the holiness of God would absolutely consume us. So God gives mercy. The prophet Jeremiah describes this overwhelming feeling in Lamentations 3. If you ever really want to feel really good about yourself, read Lamentations 3. He basically says, "My soul is continually reminded of my deserved suffering under the wrath of God." Continually. Every time I look in the mirror, I see it. And chapter 3 of the book of Lamentations is this long, drawn out, rather depressing list of afflictions that Jeremiah and his people are receiving because of their sinfulness and because of the holiness of God. He sums it all up in verse 20 when he says, "When I remember these afflictions, my soul is devastated within me." In other words, when I remember how holy God is and how sinful I am, my soul is devastated within me. That's what the holiness of God does. It devastates us. And this is a really hard chapter, chapter 3, of a really hard book to read, mainly because it's a mirror reflection of our own sinfulness. But just when you are ready to close the book and call it quits, just when you are ready to take some antidepressants and say, I need something to help me here, Jeremiah ends the passage and the chapter with these beautiful words. What a great promise for us to memorize. Listen to these words. "But to this I call to mind, and therefore have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning." We were dead, we were disobedient, we were doomed, as the Apostle Paul tells us in Ephesians 2, chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. And then in verse 4, he says, "But God, being rich in what? Mercy. Because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead, made us alive in Christ. By grace you are saved." That's why we need a Savior. Incidentally, do you know the difference between mercy and grace? Mercy is when you don't get what you deserve, okay? Grace is when you get what you don't deserve. And we see this worked out beautifully at the cross of Christ, right? On the cross, Jesus dies for our sins. And so he takes our sins. He takes our guilt. He takes our condemnation. He takes the wrath of God. All the things that we deserve, he takes from us on himself. That's mercy. And in turn, he gives us his righteousness. He gives us his holiness. He gives us a right standing before God that we would never deserve. That's grace. And that's why we sing, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. So Mary sings to magnify God, God her Savior, a Savior who is mighty, a Savior who is holy, a Savior who is merciful. But there's one more very important attribute she sings about. And this is an attribute we often forget, and it is an attribute that is maybe one of the most important. She sings about God's sovereignty. She sings about God's sovereignty. In verse 51, he has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones. He has exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. At Christmas, we celebrate a child, the Bible says, who the government will be on his shoulders. But this child will soon be a king with a government that has no end. He is sovereign over the rule of this nation, this world, and this universe. I'm going to say something that's going to be really controversial, okay? It's going to offend some of you. And it's even political. And I say controversial things up here all the time because y'all don't pay me and you can't fire me. Okay? So I can say those things and get by with them. Y'all don't know my email address or anything like that. So, but I never say anything political up here. I just don't know that that's the place for it. I just want to preach the gospel. I want to preach the gospel. But I'm going to say something controversial and political right now. Okay? And it goes like this. It was 100% God's will that Donald Trump be elected to the office of president this last term. I'm saying that in West Virginia, okay? You're like, of course it was, by golly. But listen, before you start breaking out the Trump flags and your MAGA hats, it was also 100% God's will that Joe Biden be the president-elect that he is now. And again, we don't know how this is going to work out. We don't know how any election will work out. But God does. And whether it is for the blessing of a nation, or whether it is the cursing of a nation, or the judgment of a nation, God sets kings on thrones, and God removes kings from thrones. Amen. And so we can be comforted with that. We can be comforted with the sovereignty of God, that through politics and pandemics, God is in control. He knows what's going on. God sets rulers in place and brings them down. He scatters the proud and exalts the humble. He fills the hungry and empties the rich. He brings peace and calamity. He heals and he hurts. He fills and he empties. And as R.C. Sproul says, if there is one single molecule in the universe running around loose, totally free of God's sovereignty, then we have no guarantee that a single promise of God will ever be fulfilled. But we do have that guarantee because there is not one rogue molecule in this universe that God is not sovereign over. And so when we sing of God's sovereignty, we can sing like Mary. Isaiah chapter 45 is one of my favorite passages when it speaks to this political upheaval and the sovereignty of God. And Isaiah asks this rhetorical question that I think is great. He says, why do the nations rage? Like, why all the hubbub? Why is everybody in such a turmoil? Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. And how does God respond? He who sits on His throne in heaven laughs. Is you kidding me? Donald Trump? Joe Biden? The Lord holds them in derision. That means He mocks them. He makes fun of them. And He says, I am the Lord. There is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west, there is none beside me. I am the Lord. There is no other. Now, why is this important? Why should we trust in and sing about the sovereignty of God? Because, again, only then can we look at everything that's going on in our world and know that it's going to be okay. That God's going to make all things right. That we can trust in Romans 8:28. It says, all things are working together for good for those who trust God and are called according to His purpose. And you can only trust that if you trust in the sovereignty of God. Which leads directly to one final point in closing. I'll close with this. Not only did Mary magnify God by singing about a Savior, and not only did she magnify God by singing about His attributes, but finally, number three, Mary magnified God by singing about His promises. This is so important, folks. To sing about God's promises, you have to know His promises. Verse 54 and 55, He has helped His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy. If you underline words or mark in your Bible, I want you to underline that word remembrance in verse 54. He has helped His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy. And then verse 55, as she closes out her song, as He spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and his offspring forever. So underline that word remembrance and then underline that word forever. Listen, the promises that God made to Israel concerning them being a nation and sending a Messiah, the promises made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that God would multiply them like the sand on the seashore and the stars in the sky. The assurance of Moses to carry the people over to a promised land. The promises to King David that there would be a king that would sit on his throne whose rule would last forever were all promises God kept forever. And even though some 15 to 18 centuries passed, Jesus would be born to Mary, and Mary would know that God remembers His people and He keeps His promises forever. We would do well to constantly remind ourselves of the promises of God. That's why we should sing about them, because we are so easy to forget what God said He will do. So easy. I sat in my garage a couple days ago, a good friend of mine. And he came in and said, I got to talk to you. And for 2 hours, he talked about depression and about ending his life and about the darkness that was on him that he could not shake, and how he felt about himself, and how he felt about his life, and how he felt about this depression that was on him, how he felt like he was not good enough, how he felt like he needed to save people from himself and just go away and never come back. And finally, after listening to him for 2 hours telling me how he felt, I stopped him and I said, "You know what you need? You need to quit talking to yourself and listening to yourself so much. And you need to start preaching the promises of God to you. Because this might sound harsh, but it doesn't matter how you feel. The heart is deceitful and wicked. Who can know it?" The Bible says. What matters is how God feels about you. And all of God's feelings about you are tied up in truths and promises that are in the Scriptures. And all of us need that. Without the promises of God, we'll forget. And we'll all live in darkness. So Mary sings about these things. And Mary didn't know how all these things would work out. I mean, when Gabriel told her the details, she was absolutely perplexed and probably scared to death and probably a little bit skeptical, thinking, "Come on, is this really going to happen? I mean, put yourself in her sandals." And yet, some of us this Advent season are in her sandals. We are scared. We are stressed. We are confused about what the future holds and what's going to happen. Some of you are absolutely depressed about the circumstances that are going on in our world today. You can't see it. You can't see how God is in it, or even if God is in it. That's why we sing. That's why we come here and we gather and we sing, even when we don't feel like singing. We sing and then something happens. We hear the person next to us singing. And then the person on this side of us singing. The person in front of us and behind us. And soon we hear the whole congregation singing. God is a Savior. And God is merciful. And God is sovereign. And His promises are true. And we can depend on those, and we can lean on those, and we can trust on those. And then something happens. We begin to magnify God with our voices. And God is glorified in our singing. Let's sing like that this Advent season. Let's just not sing these songs like we do every year, just go through the motions and read the words and just sing the song. Let's sing with that kind of hope. Let's sing like Mary as we magnify God through the birth of His Son. Let me pray for us. Father, thank You for Mary's song. I'll admit it's often one that I skip right past and go straight to Luke 2. Straight to the birth of Jesus. Mary's song tells us something even before Jesus is born. That we have hope. In a hopeless world, hope in a Savior. Hope in a Savior who is not only mighty and holy, but hope in a Savior that is merciful, that sees us for who we are and knows our sinful, broken nature and yet still loves us enough to call us to His side and save us. Thank You for the promises that we find in this song. And help us as a church, as a congregation, to constantly point to these promises in our songs to ask, "Who are You, God? What are You like? How should we respond to You?" May all our songs this Advent season and until You come back, may all our songs point to the magnification of your Son, our Savior. And it's in His name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Greg. We're going to transition now into our time of communion. And I've said it many times, and I'll say it until the day I die. This is my favorite part of any worship gathering, but especially a worship gathering during Christmas. And I think it goes without saying that there's a lot of fear out there and in here. There's a lot of it. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We don't know what today holds. Jobs, health. We can think of a million reasons why we should be afraid. And this Christmas season is tinged with that fear, I think. But that's why we need this time, the Lord's Supper, and here's why. There's a little book full of sayings and quotes from sermons that Martin Luther once said. And if you know anything about Martin Luther, he's just a genius with words. Some a little more brash than others, but most incredible. Martin Luther said this: "Are you afraid? Are you afraid? If you're not, great. Fine. Don't pretend to be afraid. But are you afraid this morning? Then come to Him, lying in the lap of the fairest and sweetest maid. You will see how great is the divine goodness. He seeks above all else that you should not despair. Trust Him. Trust Him. Here is the child in whom is salvation." To me, there is no greater comfort given to mankind than this, that Christ became man, a child, a babe, playing in the lap and at the breast of His most gracious mother. Who will not be comforted by this sight? Now is overcome the power of sin, death, hell, conscience, and guilt. If you come to look at this gurgling baby and believe that He has come not to judge you, but to save you. And this, if you don't have one, they're over there. This is proof that Jesus Christ has come into the world, not to judge you, but to save you. So are you afraid this morning? Then take and eat. This is the body and blood of our Lord.
Baby boy would someday walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with His hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked God?
thank you guys for joining us. We got a little Mary Did You Know in there, I guess. No lights and fog, however, this time. So let me give you a couple announcements before I send you out on a benediction. First off, Greg Lucas's email is greglucas5. First announcement is thank you guys for participating in our partnership with the NECO Foster Care Organization. We had 36 kiddos to adopt this Christmas to provide Christmas gifts for them, and you guys all signed up to do that. Next Sunday will be the final Sunday in which you can bring those gifts. We'll give you more details in our weekly email, and Laura Keffer will also make sure that you know when and where and how to do that. If you have any questions, you should have already been contacted about that. And I think we're going to have an extra day as well, not just next Sunday to collect if next Sunday doesn't work. And then the last thing that I want to mention to you is we've discontinued our kids ministry on Sundays for all of the relevant reasons that I'm sure you know of. But we don't want to leave you in the lurch in serving you in discipleship and serving those kids and all the parents involved in that. And so today on our YouTube channel and Facebook page, we have some resources going out at 5 o'clock to equip you to do Advent. That is a regular conversation and question I get asked every year from parents is how do we celebrate this rhythm and season of Advent with candles and wreaths and songs and activities? And the answer is really there's not really any wrong way to do it. A lot of great resources and tools out there to equip you to make it meaningful regardless of your life stage and whether you're a single parent or a grandparent or whether you want to do things every day or just on Sundays. A lot of things going on. And so Amanda Weaver and Holly Martin, two of our kids' leaders, have put together a video introducing the concept and the process and then equipping and giving you some tools to do that. So 5 o'clock today on our YouTube channel as well as on Facebook. And then thank those leaders for serving us so well. All right, let me send you out with a benediction of this Advent Sunday. As the Advent season fills us with longing, waiting, and hoping, may you, the people of Redemption Church, sing like Mary. When fear strikes your heart, may faith have the final say. When doubt clouds your mind, may God's promises lift the fog. When sin seeks to have the last word, may God's grace speak a better word. For the Lord our God is gracious, merciful, holy, and sovereign. His promises are sure, His grace is sufficient, His mercy is true, and by His grace you too can sing like Mary. For behold, from now on, all nations will call you blessed, because He who is mighty has done great things for you, and holy is His name. So go now, magnify the Lord, rejoice in God, your Savior. Amen. You're dismissed.